Hi, Elaine.
Mute. Hi, can you hear me now?
I can, yes.
How do I make this a full screen? Show active speaker.
If up on the right hand side it says view.
It says what?
View. Do you see a little button? Then just click on that.
Yep.
And hit full screen. Does yours say full screen?
Yep.
Does that help?
Nope, it didn't go there.
It didn't go there.
Nope. That's weird.
So also in the very top, there's a white box. There's a white ribbon across the top, a white line across the top, or a white. And there's, you should see a minus, what looks like a minus sign and a box and then an X. Do you see that?
On my toolbar?
Yeah, way up on the top, it's on your Zoom meeting. Are you on the Zoom meeting?
The I don't know part. Where that is. What's on my main screen?
Maybe it's,
is my email. I tried to get to the that's what I said. What's going on here?
<I don't know.
laughs> What?
I'm not a very technical person. I'm probably not the one to help you.
I'm going to get out of Safari. I don't know if that's going to cut you off.
It won't bother me. So you can go out and try to come back on and see if it can fix it. We'll be here.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, John.
All I have is your little box on the side, but that's okay. I can follow. I don't have you on full screen for some reason. I don't know why.
Interesting. And do you have it on speaker view or gallery?
So I hadn't even signed in. So I was shocked when I saw you come up on there because I was just about to sign in.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
You might just want to sign out and try to sign back in and see what happens.
It says show the thumbnail video. Nope.
Huh.
Let's see. Show active speaker. Yeah. Nope. Nope. Hide the thumbnail, whatever that means. No. Nope. I don't know how to get out because I can't pull it. I can't pull up.
Oh,
the
you
screen.
Can't. You can't. You don't see the leave button?
No, there's nothing.
Oh, interesting.
All I have is your face and my face. That's it.
I'd like to say there are
worse. Why am I not getting in here?
I'd like to say there are worse options, but.
Yeah, really, huh? Oh my God, that's funny.
Yes, I'm so sorry. I don't know how to. I don't know how to help you.
I don't even know how to get out. That's really weird.
That is weird. You can't put your cursor on and move things around so that. That the actual window moves, huh?
I can put you in the middle of my screen, but that's all I can do.
That's all I can do. Interesting.
That's very odd. So I don't know how to get the meeting on my screen. It's just the ones that are speaking, but that's all right because I can still follow anyway. So, but I'm not going to be able to sign out. That's the other thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
I don't know how to help you.
Oh, boy.
I barely can help myself on these things.
I know, really. And, you know, it's funny because my granddaughter, every time she sees my name come up on the phone, she says to her mother, oh, God, it's Meme again. What does she mean?
You're French, too?
Yeah.
That's what we call my husband's mom.
I don't even know how to get out of here.
That is so bizarre.
That is bizarre. Quit Safari. I already did that. So you're on my main screen, but the meeting is not there. So I won't even be able to sign out. That's what I said. And there's no bar at the top. There's not. It's just a black box. And
a black box?
Yeah. The black box at the top has a minus sign, a small, like a dash, and then a wider dash, then two dashes. That's it.
Do the dash.
I tried that.
Oh, and it didn't do anything?
No. Nope.
try clicking all those buttons.
I did try them all. The minus says hide the thumbnail video. The one next to it says show the active speaker. And the one next to that says show thumbnail video. And I've clicked every one of those and nothing changes.
Huh.
Yeah.
Hmm.
That's what I said. Well, I'm going to listen in and you just have to kick me out when it's time for me to get out.
Okay.
We'll tap you on the shoulder and say it's time.
Right. I can tell you who's here. John Feuerbach is here. I'm here. Chris Olney is here. Beth Heise is here. Troy Scarborough is here. I'm sorry if I've mispronounced your name, Troy. Irene just checked in and Sarah is in.
Or connecting.
And Elaine. Yeah, that's who I was talking to. Elaine here. Elaine can't seem to make her computer work the way she wanted. That's why I was telling her who is here.
Oh, okay. Do you want me to mute myself, Sue?
It usually helps. I'm not hearing any feedback now, but most people usually we do that just so John doesn't get feedback. And once it starts, we're just chatting now.
at this moment, we only have three members: myself, Chris, and Sarah.
Yep.
Correct. All right.
Yeah.
Sarah, so good. Got her
so
power
glad
back.
To be here. Yes.
I did hear.
It's getting cold.
there you are, Elaine.
Yep.
Now you're showing up for us.
Yeah. Huh. As long as you can see me and I can hear you, that's it. Do you want me to mute myself though?
That's fine. Yeah. Joan said she might be a little bit late because she's at a CPC meeting. Peggy is going to try. She's going to call in because she didn't have power back, although she may have it now. Muffin will not be attending because she did not have power available.
And Joan was saying that she'll be at Caldwell Banker if I'm looking at the right email, and that she invited people who might have issues at home or so to join her at her office. So hopefully she'll sign
That's
in.
Nice of her.
My guess is that Muffin has her power back because I think she's on the same circuit I am.
Okay. This earlier today, she said she was still without.
Yeah, I got it back at like 4:30.
Oh, good. Nice.
We'll hope we have. We'll hope we have.
And then we're also.
One more.
We have.
Is Chris only joining?
Yeah.
Here.
Hi, Chris.
Hi there, Sarah. By the way, you did a great job the other night under difficult circumstances.
Oh, thank you.
Beth, do you know if Gretchen's available?
I just said, I wonder if I should call Gretchen.
Why don't you?
She might be asleep. She took care of my grandson today. I'm going to give her a call.
Yeah, do that. That'd
Thank
be great.
You.
So while we're waiting, I'd like to introduce everybody to Troy Scarborough from Essex.
Thanks, Chris.
Yeah, Troy and I met a couple of weeks ago, and it turns out Essex is starting up an affordable housing trust. And so Troy invited me to a meeting last night of the Essex group, and it was kind of interesting to talk to them. They're just starting off, and they were very interested in what Manchester was trying to do. So and we talked about some regional approaches to things that might be benefiting to everybody. And so I'm glad Troy is tuned in to see us up front and live.
Yeah, I appreciate you guys allowing me to come join and listen in and learn from the experience of you guys having a trust in place already as we're looking to do the same. And a little bit of background on me, I actually work for East Boston Savings Bank as well. And my day job is a lender into the affordable housing space. So I've done a lot of work with low-income housing tax credits and working with the alphabet soups of DHCD and the likes, structuring and putting together both the debt side and the equity placements on projects in the affordable housing space. So hopefully we can learn something and maybe even together we might be able to find some ways to work together regionally, but our sister towns are so close. I figured, you know, share the mind share here to see if we can get more done.
Share the pain.
Yeah, that's great. Damn it. We, Troy, can you see us or are you on the phone?
I can see you. I'm technically driving. I left our bank got bought by Rockland Trust and we had our final bank farewell dinner tonight. They're carrying on, but I owe Chris for him joining ours. I had to attend to hear this one. And so I snuck out and I'm in my truck listening.
You, there's no such thing as technically driving. You either are, Troy, or you're not. We won't distract you with anything else then.
Gretchen, are you there?
I am.
You are. Nice. Excellent.
Yeah. All right. Good.
You are accused of taking a nap.
I was not. I think I own the slowest computer in the world. It just took me 5 minutes to get into here. And I think that was probably Beth that said that.
Exactly.
That I was taking care of her grandson. So well, that's why.
I said that. I quantified.
That's the true love of a sister.
Why don't we wait just another, I've got 4 minutes after. Let's just put it out another minute to give Joan an opportunity to sign in and then we can start. But right now we have four, so we technically have a quorum under Affordable Housing Trust rules, 4 of the 7, but let's see if we can get Joan and perhaps Peggy.
Doesn't look like Tanglewood has any power.
So it looks like all of the rest of you do have power though. So that's good.
I had a ZBA meeting last night. Not a single person had power.
I think Pine Street
you're
is
kidding.
How'd you I do think that?
Most of the town was out.
Yeah.
Know. Well, for 24 hours, really.
We just 30. Came back at 4:30.
At 4:30?
Mm-hmm. We had a tree take out a pole at the end of Bennett.
Oh.
Did everyone call in on phones? Were you able to hold your meeting?
Yeah, we deferred all new applications to next month and just had to vote on the continuance to move Got that you. Next month. So yeah, everyone Got called you. In. And I had troubles getting in and being host and mess.
I've got some refugees from Old Essex Road arriving to take a shower in a minute.
Well, why don't we get going? I got 6:07. I don't want to keep people waiting, and Joan knows where to find us. Having 4 of the 7, we do have a quorum, so why don't we get going? My name is John Feuerbach, Chair of the Manchester Affordable Housing Trust, here with Chris Olney, Sarah Melnish, Gretchen Wood, and we also appreciate the assistance of Sue Brown, town planner, who's with us. And then we have some other residents or folks who have joined us here. So I just want to call the meeting to order. An agenda has been issued. We have 9 items, so we can walk through the item. The first item.
John, does the MHA need to call their meeting to order?
I don't believe the MHA has got a formal meeting tonight. Am I correct?
No, it's not. No.
Oh, it was posted as a joint meeting. Okay.
It wasn't. It was not posted as a joint meeting.
That's what the agenda says.
That's what it says, yeah.
Joint.
Oh.
Aha. Okay, well, listen, that's my oversight. So why don't I call the meeting to order for the Manchester Affordable Housing Trust. And I'll give an opportunity to the Manchester Housing Authority to call their meeting to order if they have the...
I'm not sure they have a quorum, do they?
Yeah, if they have a quorum.
Yeah, we do. Yeah,
we do. Okay, so I'm Elaine Persons. I'm the chair for the Manchester Housing Authority. And I'll call the meeting to order if I have Beth Heisey in attendance. Gretchen Wood, is Irene here?
Looked like she was here.
So
she's on mute.
Yes,
hi, Irene. I am here.
Okay, you am here. Okay. Irene and so we have four.
Well, Irene's not a member of the board, but
right, yeah. So
so but we only really need don't. 3 out of 4. That's a quorum.
We need 3 out of 4. Okay, yeah. So we have that.
Yeah. You all set?
Yes, I'll call the meeting to order.
Excellent.
And my apologies, that was simply, I didn't take it off of the last one. So I apologize, I'll make sure I.
So then let's focus on items that are of note of an importance to both the Affordable Housing Trust and the Housing Authority. And that just so happens to be items 2 and 3 on the agenda. The first item is update on the SEMA warrant articles for fall town meeting, and then the second would be the update on the Affordable Housing Trust Housing Authority Housing Project Survey. The update on the CMA warrant articles to fall town meeting. I guess there's a couple things going on. Since we had our last meeting on the 29th, I had an opportunity to talk to Jay, Bothwell, and Denny. And rather than posing ideas for improving the articles upon further review and in discussion with, I think at least one, perhaps two other Affordable Housing Trust members, I said it based on what we heard the other night, you know, when we had the meeting in September, it disappeared to us inappropriate timing. Inappropriate message that could be sent. It could be confusing to townsfolks in that, on the one hand, we're promoting community affordable housing, yet these articles appear as though they would be more restrictive. Long story short, I said, and also there's a public safety concern of the moderator. It's gonna be an indoor meeting. We have still COVID and mask requirements. So I suggested what should be and what could be considered is a move to pass. And that would be an action by which at the time of the town meeting, those items came up rather than entertaining a discussion. Someone from CUNA would say, upon further review, given the situation, et cetera, we move to pass on the articles. So in essence, it would be a punt. It would not be considered. The town moderator would then this move, and these articles would then be left for a discussion at another day, perhaps the spring meeting or who knows when. Both Denny and Jay heard me. I haven't heard back from them. I got an email from Bill. And I've got a name block, Bill Cross, the other day, where he in essence said that I understand, John, that you had talked to Denny and Jay and we're considering a move to pass, et cetera. Can we talk? So that is the extent of my conversations on it. Chris, I know there was a presentation at the planning board. Was it sometime?
It was last night, actually. Or two nights ago.
Okay, is there anything worth discussing?
Well, so there are a couple of things. One thing is that the planning board voted 5-2 and unanimously in opposition to both of the warrant articles. The unanimous one was the driveway, and the fire chief attended the meeting and he made a statement that basically he saw no safety concerns with access roads in excess of 500 feet as long as they were well designed. the other one was the pace of development warrant, and that was a 5-2 vote in opposition, with two members suggesting that the warrant be approved. So in any case, the planning board is going to submit a report in opposition to the two warrant articles. The members of the SEMA board who were attending the meeting indicated that they were considering passing on the two articles at the meeting. So we're waiting to see what happens there. So
I'm sorry. Comments, housing authority, colleagues, friends, Affordable Housing Trust, colleagues, friends.
I really think it would be to everybody's advantage if they do that. I think it would certainly help us, and I think in the long run it will help them, because it's, I almost think that it wouldn't even pass Attorney General. I don't know how you can make laws like that.
And the other thing is way too late to have any influence on the SLV project.
Mm.
If that's the intent, it's way too late.
That's one thing. That's one thing I mentioned to them in my conversation.
I mean, that can be addressed outside of any zoning changes for the SLV.
Okay. Well, I will call Bill on Sunday. I can email Sue the content of my conversation, and considering it's not a public meeting forum, I could ask that Sue forward the email to everyone, and if anyone has a comment, to respond back to her individually and separately, and not to the group, so as to not arouse suspicion that we're having a public meeting.
John, I have a problem with that. I just have a problem with doing things behind the scenes. I think the question is do we want to take a vote tonight on whether or not we support these articles? If they pass over them, then we don't have to present that vote. But it seems to me that if it's going to affect us, we need to take a vote. That's my opinion.
All right. In that case, I would like to make a motion.
I love you, Chris. I like you.
I would like to move that the Affordable Housing Trust express its opposition to the two citizen petition warrants, which might affect the MHA renovation project.
Hmm.
Do I have a second?
I'll second that.
All in favor? Raise
your hand.
Aye. Well, actually, let's do it. How about if we do it separately? Chris, I believe, is offering a motion for the Manchester Affordable Housing Trust. If we can do that, and then if the Housing Authority would want to do something similarly and have their own separate vote, that would be invited. So for now, for Chris, do we have a second for Chris?
I seconded.
Yes, Sarah did.
Affordable Housing Trust, those in favor?
Aye.
So let the records show that we have this speaker here, we have Sarah, we have Chris, and we have Gretchen.
I don't think I can vote because I haven't actually been appointed by the selectman yet. They've been notified of it, but they haven't taken the vote yet.
Okay, so then I guess I got a technical question. Do we technically have a quorum here?
Oh, I didn't think of that before.
Well, how many members do we have?
Well,
six, if Gretchen has not been appointed.
We have five.
Who's gone?
No, so we have four then who are voting. Myself, Sarah, Chris. Oh, I'm sorry. We would have three. I'm looking at myself, so I'm counting now. Here's one, here's two.
Who left the trust, Sue?
Nancy.
Nancy.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So we have six. So is three technically a quorum? I think not.
Yeah, where's Joan? Somebody call Joan quick.
Or we can table it until she comes on. I do expect that she will show up.
Yeah, I think you. I think a majority would be four.
I think you're right.
I'll text her right now.
Yeah.
And this is what messy looks like, Troy.
I'm learning already.
So does the Manchester Housing Authority want to make a motion and we'll table our vote?
Yeah, I will make that motion for the Housing Authority that we table our vote until, the same motion that they made up for the Housing Trust.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. And now you have to say all in favor.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, unanimous. Thank you, Beth. I'm writing and not thinking.
It took me a long time to remember to do that for ADA committee. So,
well, thank you for being patient with me.
Joan just got back to me saying, can you give me 10 minutes? Why don't we continue on our journey here? And when Joan arrives, we can come back to the motion. But at least we have the Housing Authority voting to oppose the CIMA warrant articles. Anything else on just that particular item, which is the update on the CIMA warrant articles? Why don't we then go to the update on the Housing Authority Affordable Housing Trust Housing Project Survey. And for folks who are new to this, it's a survey that we put together and it was designed to go to folks who live in and around the Public Housing Authority sites, in addition to the Pleasant Street site. And then there's a second survey, and I believe it was issued, right, Sue, that went to the town at large.
It didn't go to the town at large.
What's that?
It didn't open go to the town at large.
It's open to the town at large.
It's open to the town at large. And it was made available in a couple of ways, one of which was posting it on our website. And Sue, you also got contact information of folks in and around the impacted sites and
yes,
direct outreach. And yes, in essence, we were just soliciting comments on neighborhood conditions, traffic, but then we honed in on the concept of development on each of the sites. So Sue, do you want to talk about that? I know you sent something out, unless I'm mistaken, you sent something out earlier today. I had a chance to look at it probably around an hour ago. I thought it was some interesting findings or information to date. I think it was like 156 responses.
Yeah, so the two surveys, one was for the neighborhood. So we had sent something out to all of the neighborhoods around the three housing authority sites. However, there was a glitch in that mailing and they got a wrong link. So they got the link to the DPW one, and that is my fault. I got calls from a number so I recognized it early on, and then we tried to, so we sent, we put things on the social media, et cetera, and got the right link up, and it's on the town's website, et cetera. And then we also have the one for the DPW site, which we did send to the abutters in the general neighborhood, but then also made aware through social media that anyone could answer that because it is a public resource and we wanted everyone to be able to talk about that. So we did that outreach. There were 157 responses to date regarding the DPW site, which was It's about a half and half mix of people in the neighborhood, in and around the neighborhood, and people who are not, because they identified themselves as such. And so far we've only had 26 on the neighborhood, and I think that's in part because of the mistake that I made. Also, it's a little bit of a smaller group, but interestingly, most of the respondents were from Loading Place Road, or the majority of the respondents, neighborhood-wise.
So is that a reflection of the fact that the people who live at Newport Park and the Plains don't have access to doing a survey online?
No, because this wasn't to the residents. This was, we did the outreach to the neighborhood.
This was the neighborhood.
Yeah, that's right.
But it included the residents, didn't it?
I see what you're saying.
It might have included. No, we didn't send it to residents. I didn't have. I didn't send emails to individual, because I don't have individual property. Okay. I only have property owners who would have gone to affordable. But we could certainly give that to them.
What I'm taking away from what Sarah said is if there's any question about technology with regard to residents of the PHA, could we print out a survey and issue them to individuals at the developments, and then just collect them back and then log them in ourselves?
Yeah, it might skew the results in our favor because it says, do you approve of this? And I'm hopefully they all will, because it's to improve their site.
Well, we don't know. I mean, our intention was to get a survey and take the temperature of residents of the site. So whether or not they receive it by email and by a link or paper.
Yeah, no, it was for the neighborhood.
But my guess is that some of these responses were from residents when I look at them.
Oh, interesting. It might have been, but anyway.
They talk about gardening space. That's a resident. That's not a neighbor.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So that's interesting. So, but I think, you know, it's interesting, overwhelmingly, the majority have responded so far have been in support of the DPW site. You have the results, so you can look at those. I think the one where they were most mixed in terms of the neighborhood was it seems to me that the Loading Place Road neighbors were least receptive to a change in that site. But again, it's just some takeaways. But I think it is worth reading. There's a lot of feedback, just like our master plan survey, when we allowed people to answer open-ended questions, get a lot of information. And I think it's really helpful. There's a lot of things for us to consider and to share with a potential developer going forward, including, you know, conditions of stormwater on site and others. So yeah. I think it's helpful. We haven't closed it. We'll keep it open, and I will continue to ask Tiffany to keep putting it out there, and then the trust can decide when they want to close it. The only question is, I have, should I resend? It was a couple hundred dollars and a bit of work, but if anyone thinks, if the trust thinks I should resend to the DP, to the neighborhood groups with a corrected link, I could do that.
I would say yes.
Would take $100 or so, I think, of your budget, I think, generally.
Given that our number is only 26, right?
Yeah, I mean, is there a way to have the results separated by property?
No.
So even though, aren't they separate questionnaires, or is it one questionnaire that covers all three properties?
There's one questionnaire for all three properties. You can tell from some of the answers where they live. But
I was going to say the same thing.
Yeah.
Well, my quick take of it, I want to spend some more time over the weekend looking at it, is the standard answers. I thought they were they're favorable on a number of counts, but that it's when you get into the comments, you see there's some, you know, some pretty critical points, and there's some, you know, that's where it gets a little, how do you monitor it and what people say? Sometimes it gets a little harsh.
No, John.
You know, It's like a public meeting, but it is, you know, it does help us. And I think one of the principal reasons for wanting to do it was for us to understand the level of support and the level of opposition. So I think it's very helpful.
And to me, it was interesting that at Newport Park, there clearly was an abutter concerned about flooding type issues. And it seems to me that's something that could be addressed.
He called me. He was the first one to call me, and I had a nice long conversation with him. He's lived there, forever. in his lifetime. And then that was my thought too. I'm like, maybe this is an opportunity to actually help. Right. So I think this is all good information to get, and I'm sure they appreciate an opportunity to be heard on it.
Or acquire the properties.
Yeah, really. The thing that struck me was people seem to be most concerned about architectural style, having the new project fit into the neighborhood, which makes perfect sense. Of course they would. But it was good to see that, you know, that kind of a response instead of. And the other thing that struck me was that DPW is not a great neighbor. People serve. We're particularly pleased at having the DPW next door. So, yeah.
Well, go ahead, John.
I saw one comment. I don't know whether it was serious or not. Can we expand the cemetery and combine it with affordable housing?
Right. It is actually serious. And that's where we just need to get a little more information out. The DPW, we've done a cemetery report, and we've identified areas within existing cemeteries where we can expand for a fairly long term. And they're actually starting some of that work and preparing for some of that work. But that's information that's not out there, but we'll need to get out there so that doesn't come up as a negative. I did think that most of the objections for the DPW site were based on fear of traffic impacts.
Right, and number of units.
I was gonna say the same thing, Sarah. I saw a couple points where people were, we just been floating around 30, and we say, listen, it's very preliminary, but people were, they were talking about units.
And I thought it was interesting that some of the neighbors were saying it would be great if there was a playground or something to attract in the neighbors. I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, just how about on the item of Sue's suggestion, how about I want to make a motion that the Affordable Housing Trust approves up to a reasonable amount to enable Sue to resend the surveys to the neighborhood group. I think, Sue, you mentioned $100, $200. Do I have a second?
Second. That was Sarah.
All in favor?
I still have a lot of stamps from the first mailing. I think I have almost 50 of them. So we won't have to spend that $25. Okay. Actually, it's more than that.
But just to finish the vote, I saw Sarah support. I support Chris only.
Yeah, sure. I'm supportive. Yeah.
Gretchen?
No, not Gretchen. Joan.
Not me.
Joan.
Oh, hi.
Yes. Only because she hasn't been appointed.
No, I forgot about that. We got to get Gretchen to go down to the clerk's office quickly, right?
I went to sign to get sworn in, and she said, "Well, I don't have anything here that you were appointed." I said, "Oh,
the selectmen who've got to approve it."
Yeah.
Yes.
Gretchen, do you know if it's on their meeting for Monday?
No, I don't. Well, she sent them a letter or an email a good 10 days ago, I would say. So hopefully it is. I can check it.
Okay.
If we can check on that, that'd be great. So then, Joan, you're okay?
Definitely. Today is the deadline for the agenda, and we're beyond the time frame.
So, okay.
Although can they make an addition after that? No.
No, 48 hours, and it excludes holidays. I mean, they could, So today's the last day to post it. They can't call an emergency for that.
Got you. as long as it's done before our next meeting.
Right. Anything else on the survey? I think, why don't we, Sue, if we can have it as an item on our next agenda, it will the approximately 1 month between now and our next meeting will give each of us an opportunity to look at it, get a better sense of what we're seeing, and we could have a conversation. Hopefully, maybe I could help us shape the direction of the plan. And again, I say that knowing this is it's just a proof of concept. It's nothing cast in stone. And we're really trying to take the next step, which would be hopefully get the town support for our warrant items on in November, so that we can indicate such in a request for proposal. And I think the fun really starts when we put out the proposal and we are in a position to evaluate applications and hopefully select the strongest and then that applicant would really start nailing down specifics and stuff.
I think it does. I think it can help us in the development of the RFP though, to talk about.
Yes.
You know,
Yeah, that's right. That's correct. Yeah. I mean,
well, speaking of warrant articles, Joan is here, so we can now take a vote on the.
Yes, thank you very much, Chris. You want to pose it again, please?
Sure. I'd like to move that the Affordable Housing Trust oppose the two warrants proposed by the Citizens Group at the next town meeting, at the November 13th town meeting.
For Joan's.
And I seconded it.
Great. And now for Joan's benefit, is there any discussion?
Do you think that they'll withdraw those? Do you think they'll?
It's to be determined. I know I told other members of the Affordable Housing Trust and the Housing Authority since our last meeting, I did have a conversation to talk to some CMO folks, and I gave a number of reasons why it's not the right time, it's not the right place, it'd be inconsistent with what we're proposing and what we're, it would send a terrible message. And for that reason, we strongly suggest that you move to, I think it's called move to pass.
Passover. Yeah.
And then Chris also mentioned that it was either last night or two nights ago, there was a presentation and which led to two opposing votes from the planning board.
No, and yes, two opposing votes on each
on
the
both
articles.
Yes. On
so they both. Would the planning board will recommend will not recommend passage of this.
So with any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And John, just for technical purposes. Under a Zoom meeting, you're required to do a roll call vote.
Okay, thank you. Sarah Valish, your vote.
Yes.
Great. Joan?
Yes.
Chris?
Yes.
And I vote yes. And we'll have to wait on Gretchen, I hate to say. We know how you feel, but. So we have a four, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you. Anything?
John, I ask a quick question on the surveys that you guys were talking about there. Is that publicly available, the outcomes of that? I ask selfishly, Essex residents aren't that different from Manchester residents. We might be able to learn something from the feedback that you got in those surveys as well.
So I think we'll post them. This is just as kind of a snapshot in time. I think it's up to the committee. We can post the snapshot now. We can wait and post it later, but I would leave it to the trust.
No need to do anything quickly. Chris will attest to. We are moving rather slowly to even just getting our trust established. So, whenever you're ready, I'm not looking to create work. Just it'd be great to see it when it is ready.
Sure.
Sue, how quickly did people respond to the letter that did go out? Did they do it right away?
Yeah, pretty quickly. I got calls right away when the link didn't work. and I thank you for not asking me to pay the cost of the resend. Yeah, so I got some feedback pretty quickly. So I would assume that when it goes out again that they would, or maybe the people that were really interested found a way to get it because they knew the intent. But I think it's good faith. And I did have one gentleman tell me I had to resend it.
Well, I would suggest that we don't put anything out there until we get the second round back.
Sounds
especially
right.
If we expect that it will come back pretty quickly.
Sounds right, Joe.
When you say put something out there, you mean like the publicize the result?
Yeah, don't you think it would be better to have everything in it?
Yeah, that, I agree. And something about just seeing all those comments all over the place, I just don't know what's the proper way to present them. I think it's very easy to present the fixed answers to our questions. Right. Do we just have a free flow of comments following, or is there any way we can organize them?
So I don't know on this survey what capacity we have, because I don't know what level the town bought, but you can do just the black and white answers. You can get the others and put them in addendum, or there are different ways that you can organize it. At least I've been able to in the past. I'll have to see what this level of SurveyMonkey that we purchased allows us to do.
But, or even not do the specific answer, not publicize the specific answers, just do bar graphs.
You don't have to. You can just say how many people responded, but
Various bar graphs on the questions. I don't know.
Yeah, I agree. But what I was referring to is the various and numerous comments.
Mm-hmm. So maybe it could be lumped that there were, dozens of people that responded this way. Or, well, that'll be in the bar graph too, but you might have a couple of representative comments.
Yeah, I think that's okay for analyzing ourselves, but I think people will want to know. I think they'll ask that we share them.
The unvarnished.
It's okay. We're gonna get criticism.
And this
you're
is
a great too. You're a great trust, but don't think that you're you're not immune.
Sue, as a guide, when the master plan was being mm-hmm. finalized and yep. whatever surveys were done. Mm-hmm. Were you in a situation such as this where they had general comments? And if so, how were they handled?
Yeah, absolutely. We published all of them. And the only thing we redacted, if there were personal names that were used, and there were a few. and so we redacted, attacks, personal attacks, but everything else we put in.
I think that's good to know. We don't have to make a decision now. I think if we can put it on the calendar for our next meeting, we can certainly have an opportunity to talk about it. By then, you'll have resent to the quote unquote neighborhood. And then we'll have an opportunity, maybe we're closing it out by the end of November, or certainly by the next time we meet. And then we could talk about next steps and we can discuss.
Speaking of next time, it's 4 weeks is Thanksgiving. So I'm just wondering when you might be meeting, just so I can put it on my calendar.
You want to take it out the week after to December 1st or December 2nd?
Not the 1st is a Wednesday, right?
That's correct, yeah.
So. Not the first. I have a 40B meeting that night.
How does the second sound?
Second seems fine.
Why don't we'll put that down then, December 2nd. Is 6 o'clock?
Are we getting to the end of the meeting? I don't have the agenda in front of me.
But no, we were just jumping ahead to help us in trying to define when we would come back on the surveys. And
December. We have other stuff to discuss that the Manchester Housing Authority doesn't necessarily need.
That's correct. I was prepared to invite the Housing Authority to leave if they so choose in a minute, but I figured since someone did suggest the meeting time, is 6 o'clock all right, or is 6:30?
This is good for me.
6 o'clock is good.
Six is fine.
Would people, anyone object to 6:30? No. I'm transitioning back to real live work outside of and it's going to require me commuting. So 6 o'clock might be tricky, but 6:30, I think I can probably swing.
Okay, that's fine.
Is that all right?
Yeah.
Great.
What was the time, 6:30?
6:30 on December 2nd.
Okay.
Anything else on the survey or matters related to the Housing Authority Affordable Housing Trust plan?
Oh, I have something. Actually, this is about the town meeting. So we have these, our warrant articles, and the Housing Authority is certainly interested in those articles as well. And what I want to discuss is whether we want to make a presentation to town meeting, or who's going to be the spokesperson, someone from the Housing Authority and the Affordable Housing Trust. I just want to put that out there and see what people think.
Right, so Chris is referring to the non-binding votes that are warrant articles asking about the use of the DPW site to support this and the use of it and foregoing some funds, some profits for it. Mm. Yeah, it's a good point, Chris. It's kind of the last time to kind of.
Yeah, this is it.
And I would think that whatever is done would need to be exceptionally short, given the moderator's request for a short meeting. But we could ask for him. We'll have to ask for him. I think it's reasonable to present something, but.
Yeah, I agree. Thank you, Chris, for bringing that up before we split. I think it is important. We're not gonna meet again before I believe it's the 13th, that's Saturday.
That's right.
So we should have our lines straight. I think we should expect to make a short presentation. I'm perfectly fine doing with it, doing something. I do like the idea of having a joint presence of the Housing Authority and Affordable Housing Trust. So going up together, I don't know. we could figure out who says what. But certainly showing the combined forces is important. But I also think being available, so if, you know, Alan's going to open it up for discussion, right? So I think any comments, I think it'd be good to have someone from the Housing Authority as well as the Affordable Housing Trust.
Gretchen, are you willing to do that? Only I feel like I don't know enough about all of this to be able to present anything.
Yes, I will be there. I'm going to be working at it anyway, so I'll be there, and I will mostly just defer to John and probably Chris, because they really, well, they both are very good public speakers in the first place, which I'm not, and have the background and everything, but I'll be there, and if there's a question directly about the Housing Authority, I'll try to do it.
Just a question on that. Are you allowed to? Because I remember one time when I was working, I wanted to speak on something, and Alan said I could not speak. I was working at the town meeting.
Mm. Oh, really?
What are you doing, Gretchen?
I think I'm checking people in. I'll check with Alan about that, and if that's true, I'll tell Diane that I can't work.
I would hope that there's a line between responsibilities and your role as a, assuming that you have been appointed by.
I am on the Housing Authority anyway. I'm not.
That you can act in that manner and speak on behalf and not have your role as a volunteer at the meeting.
Yeah. I'll check it out with Alan and see what he says. But and if there's a problem, I'll just tell Diane. She'll be able to find somebody easy enough. That's not a problem.
Thank you.
Chris, what are your thoughts?
I think that's good. Yeah. And I think, John, you should carry the flag.
I could put some bullet points together. It's really the warrant items speak for themselves, but I think it might be just be important to provide a little quick context.
And just so people are aware, it's likely I will have to speak on behalf of the Finance Committee. We've not yet taken a vote.
That's what you would say, sir, I take it. You have not taken a vote.
We will be before the meeting.
And just on that point, I don't think I'm mistaken. I did have an opportunity to make a presentation, and some of us here on this call were at that meeting at the Finance Committee. I think it was probably 2-3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Okay, where we did request the support of the Finance Committee on the two articles. They didn't make it, you didn't take a vote that night, but.
No, there was not enough financial data available to them. So one of the members was going to look at the pro forma. And I have no clue what the result will be.
If you can stay in touch with us, if there's going to be a meeting prior to the town meeting where this matters, it will be taken up. And if you feel it might be helpful to have one of us there to, as needed, just give us a heads up.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else on the plan, town meeting, survey, SEMA, warrant articles, all related to the combined work of the Affordable Housing Trust and the Housing Authority?
I just have one comment, John.
Yes, hi, Arvin.
Hi, the consultants that we hired, wouldn't they be the best person to maybe come and maybe make a speech in front of the town meeting that day?
I hear what you're saying. I don't think we're getting into the technical matter at that point. I think I can certainly refer people to the plan and the consultant study, recognize the location of it on the Affordable Housing Trust site.
That's a lot of material. Okay.
Yeah, correct me if I'm wrong, co-members, I don't think it's a time to really delve into the details. Right. I think I would emphasize, if anything, it's a proof of concept consultant study, which has pointed us in the direction of feasibility.
Mm-hmm.
And that.
John, I think you need to clearly state that the DPW site is necessary financially in order to fix the MHA sites. That's all right. You need to say, because what people are coming back at is saying, just do the sites.
Right.
And you know, it needs to be really simple, and it needs to be, you know, this is what's required for it to be financially viable. And if you're not going to approve it.
Now, keep it simple, the DPW site is necessary.
Yeah.
And in fact, Gretchen made a great point. Of
the overall plan.
Gretchen made a great point at one meeting where she said, and the state has told us we're on our own. We have to do this on our own. And if you could make that statement again, Gretchen, I think.
Sure.
Yeah.
John, when you put your bullet points together, I think it might also be very helpful to say, the town, through its CPA, has approved over $600,000 over the past couple years in support of affordable housing. So we know that the town wants affordable housing and wants to help this. So this is just this is a continuation of that support. So I guess the point to me is, I think the townspeople have indicated that they want to support affordable housing, and to not support it when we finally come up with a project seems to be against that, you know, seems to be opposite of that.
I do think there's some confusion about the necessity of the DPW right. site. Mm-hmm. I think that we've been maybe not strong enough in saying that this whole project has to be, it has to include that site in order for it to be financially feasible.
Right. No, that's
because there's people saying, well, put it someplace else, or, you know, put it there, put it, but this is really a key point
right.
of the whole thing.
And only do four units there.
Yeah, again. There's not enough room on the existing sites to add the number.
The one for one.
Right.
And Sue, to your point that the CPA and how we've mm-hmm. got the support and that is indicative, mm-hmm. I would further mm-hmm. say that the master planning process that was concluded a couple of years ago, where there was a focus on right. the DPW site, led to the conclusion of right. housing.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. So let me.
I've got a couple of things though. I don't think we should dwell too much on the one for one because
right.
if somebody asks, we can't say that it's a requirement. All we right. can say is that the state did that once.
But I also, excuse me, I think also a very important point here that you're missing or might get across to the residents is the sacrifice that Manchester Housing Authority itself is giving up. You know, they're giving up their property in order to make this other development possible, because a development couldn't come in and just develop one site, but they need the revenue backing of the Housing Authority to support the endeavor. And, you know, they're going to put a few more extra units at the other sites, but also there's not going to be a cost to the townspeople in order to put these extra units in. And they're using that to leverage the development of that other site or help.
Yeah, in other words, the land, in other words, Irene, the land that we're taking.
Well, land, and I also feel that the units do have a value to them as well.
Sure. Yeah, point well taken.
And I think residents town may feel like, oh, they're not the only ones that are giving a piece of property that they could maybe sell to somebody at a larger amount.
So you're saying you were getting a contribution from the state by making the property available?
Yeah, and it's not just the state though, it's the Manchester Housing Authority. The deeds and everything are in the Manchester Housing Authority's name. They belong to the Housing Authority. We just have deed restrictions, so as well the other site. But I don't know, I just thought that might play as a fiddle, if you might say, to the townspeople, that they're not the only ones that are giving up something for nothing, if that makes sense. Yeah, the DPW site.
The other thing I would say, people are gonna say, why should we give up all this land for nothing? And right. I think the answer is it probably is going to be a lease and not a long-term lease and not a donation. And second, we don't know yet how much of a subsidy is required.
Right.
Maybe we don't need very much. Maybe we need a lot. We don't know yet.
Right.
And I think we need to remind people that a determination regarding the property will be made at a future town meeting when we know the exact numbers.
Exactly, yeah. This is a preliminary non-binding.
That we need in order to go out to RFP.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Sarah, to follow up your point, I would say that determination would be made after developer selection, after the refinement of the development plan and the advancement of the budgeting and the financials. We would have some sense of what is required of the DPW site.
We'd have exact numbers.
Then at that point.
Not some sense, exact numbers.
Yeah, but I would say that's the sequencing.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is just the first hurdle to even let us study it and
right.
make that determination. Yeah, it's a very good point, Sarah. It's coming back to the town. again.
And they can accept it or reject it.
Okay. Anything else? Well, I would offer to close the portion of the meeting relative to the Manchester Housing Authority and Manchester Affordable Housing Trust plan. I would invite the Housing Authority to close its portion of the meeting if they so choose, and they could stick around if they choose, or?
I move to close the Housing Authority's portion of this meeting.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Roll call.
Oh, roll call. I'm sorry. Beth?
Yes.
Gretchen?
Yes.
And myself, yes. So
thank
the meeting
you, everyone.
Is now adjourned.
And just so I don't make a mistake next time, am I posting it as a joint meeting or just a meeting?
Why don't we do a joint meeting? That's what I would suggest on behalf of the Affordable Housing Trust.
Does that work for you, Elaine and Irene and Tia?
Yep.
Matt?
Is it okay? I think that's the best way to do it. So actually, because it does more than two. All right.
Good. December 2nd at 6:30.
I will keep it as a joint meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Good night, everyone.
We will go on our way throughout the agenda for the Affordable Housing Trust items. Let's go to the Emergency Rental and Mortgage Assistance Program. That's the sequencing of the agenda. I know Peggy, by way of Sue, sent out her summary. I don't know if folks had a chance to look at it. I have a quick summary here if folks would want me to just do a quick summary.
I'd like to know how much we spent since the last update.
Okay, I don't know that. I do know that she said that 111,526 has been expended as of, I forget the date she had in her email. I could
10/28.
That's what I thought it was, yeah.
Today, isn't that today?
Yeah.
Yeah. Average assistance is $6,196. 18 clients received funds. 5 clients were deemed ineligible. 8 were, they just didn't follow up. Of the, I think she said 31, 4 have requested mortgage assistance. So that's in essence the summary that she had.
I mean, we've got what?
Go ahead.
Almost $49,000 left that we haven't spent. Didn't we do 150?
Right.
Right. So it doesn't seem to me like these numbers are changing. And I wonder if it makes sense to increase the max from 10,000 if there's some existing clients who could use more money. Or do we close out the program and get the money back? That's the decision we need to make.
For the end of the year, right?
Or I don't know.
I think.
Or I would add to your point, Sarah, for someone who has received funding assistance, but they maxed out on time.
$4.
Time and dollars, perhaps, right? Could we circle back in and say, is there still a need? Would we be open and flexible to increasing the amount of time, extending to that applicant or the amount that they've received?
I think those are
am I confusing two things? Sorry, Chris, one sec. Once you started receiving assistance, I was under the impression that there was a time cap, but is our time cap really the duration of the program?
Yeah, we extended it, I thought. Originally, I thought it was September 30th.
Yeah.
Your last meeting, you extended it to December 31st.
But we never have changed the $10,000 cap.
It was 5,000, I think, to begin with, and then it's up to 10,000.
But if there's people who've used the full 10,000, the question is, do they need more?
Yep.
Well, if we have, maybe we should ask, let's ask Action what they think.
If that's going to delay a decision till December, till our next meeting, December 2nd.
Well, okay, I guess.
But you can, you could vote to allow her to increase that amount if you wish, whether she's here or not, or says it's needed or not, just to cover your bases if you think that.
So the current cap is 10,000, is that right?
Yeah.
So I say we could extend it to 15,000.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And then if they don't need it, they don't need it, but at least they have the authorization. Because this has lasted much longer than we expected, right?
Well, see, yes, the conditions have lingered longer than we had anticipated as well. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, I'll make that motion that we extend it to 15,000 with the understanding that this will be a decision by Actionist whether or not it's needed.
I'd second that.
Any discussion? All in favor?
You have to do a roll call.
That's right. Chris?
Yes.
Joan?
Yes.
Sarah?
Yes.
I approve as well. Nice. Anything else on the relief fund?
I will let Peggy know.
That sounds great. Nice. Thank you, Sue. How about some administrative items? How about you have a motion to approve the minutes of our last meeting, September 29th, 2021, that have been sent out by Sue, and motion to approve?
I'll move they be approved.
Second?
Second.
Isn't it right then you're supposed to say any discussion right after that, right?
Yes, yep.
Any discussion?
No.
All in favor? Chris? Or, yes, those in favor. Chris?
He's on mute.
Sorry, I had to unmute. Yes.
Joan?
Yes.
Sarah?
I'll abstain because I was not present.
Okay, I approve the minutes. Nice. And then Sue sent out her technical assistance hours. Total of 16.5 hours, weekly average of 4.13. Any?
Those were all the envelope stuffing.
I don't know how you do it, sleight of hand, 4.13 hours. Any comment on that?
No.
That's great. Okay, great. And then we just have the treasurer's report here, right?
Right. So the only thing I need to report to you is that the $200,000 from the CPC is now in our checking account for the last round. So I don't have the number with me. I'm sorry, but we're $200,000 richer than we were last month.
That's a key point, that I think we're in the neighborhood of the sixes.
Yeah, we are. We're up in the sixes. And I'm sorry, I don't have that number.
Troy, for your benefit, if you're still there, that happened. That was the CPC donation that we get following a new fiscal year. So, and I was just going to say that we actually have two kind of pots of money. CPC has been the bulk of our financing, but we also have an inclusionary housing bylaw that they can contribute to. In lieu of producing an affordable housing.
And I want to say we've received approximately 100,000 from that, right?
160 something.
Yeah.
We've got a ton of money from personal donations from people.
And donations. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we've been talking about that. Whether we approve the trust alone at our spring town meeting, which is what we're shooting for. We're working on the paperwork now. We just do establish the trust, or we do establish the trust, and then we're also looking to move funds from the CPA to the trust in sort of a lump sum that we'll have to do. My understanding is that's sort of done like annually, that we have to go to town meeting to do some.
Yes.
For what you're talking about.
Yeah.
CPC allocations has to be approved at town meeting.
And in fact, we have to get that application into the CPC.
That's what I'm hoping is further down the agenda, because we need to do that by December 1.
So I'm going to make a motion that we submit an application for $200,000 to the CPC for 2022.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Chris?
Yes.
Joan?
Yes.
Sarah?
Yes.
Are you voting yes? Where's the person that usually says ask for more?
I was going to say
that's usually me.
I was going to say the same thing, but I realized that wait, we're voting. We're not in discussion, because I was going to say why 200? Why not 250?
So I just came from the CPC meeting before I got to this tonight, and they have some pretty significant asks.
Okay.
They definitely know that we're coming in. So,
good.
And I think it was last year we asked for 150, and they gave us 200. We went back and it amended our request, and we had our cheerleader on that, Sue Thorne, who is no longer on the committee. I'm not saying that that's
changed. She came back to us and say ask for more.
Yeah, but she was instrumental in upping that from, I think it was 150 to 200,000 last year.
Although I do think there is a new cheerleader in the works, is there not?
Yeah.
Woody is quite
no, he definitely is.
Affordable housing.
I think it would be a really good thing to, and maybe Sue, you and I can talk about putting that application together, or John, whoever wants to do it. But I think we really need to up it a little bit and say, you know, this is here we are right now. This is where we, you know, we've done all of this stuff. We really are moving in the direction. We see ourselves actually. It's not just treading water anymore. It's really moving forward. And I think that would be a really important thing to have in the application, so it could be right there.
And when is that need to be in by?
That needs to be done by 12/1, by December 1st.
So
John, we had a vote on the table, but you didn't vote.
Oh, I'm sorry. I vote to approve. The motion to approve it's been carried. Sue, if you could send me in Word format the 2021, and how about we could work with that as a template. I agree with Joan. I think in 2021 we upped our game and explained the different circumstances and how we're advancing. I think we can do it similarly in 2022.
I think so.
And then we can send it out to folks. I could do a first draft and send it out to folks for comment with enough time for December 1st, getting it out to CPC. Thank you.
I'll do it.
Nice. So the next item is discussion of the Citizens Housing and Planning Association, also known as CHAPA, Municipal Engagement Initiative. This was the email that circulated amongst members this past, I guess, the last 7 days. Sue, can you talk a little bit more about that, and also just the timing? Because I thought it had to be in by before today?
5 o'clock.
Okay.
The citizen, the CHAPA, Citizens Housing and Planning Association, has a program called their Municipal Engagement Initiative, whereby they will work with a community to elevate or create a citizen engagement plan specific to discussions about housing, diversity, and affordability. And this is a program that they've had going on for a while. And what they do is they will meet with a community and for a year lay out this strategy for talking to, actually it's about building a stronger coalition. So instead of just the Affordable Housing Trust carrying that torch for affordable housing, they help others get involved and build stronger coalition, more people in support of it. So they work with churches, they work with, you know, they will work with each community because each community is different, but identify all these other voices or groups that can support affordable housing. So it's an initiative, it's a technical service initiative or a technical assistance. It's not money, they actually come with us and work with us. I mean, it really just elevates the discussion in the community about affordable housing. I think it's super important. I had looked at it from out of my planning budget and had found a consultant firm in California that I was thinking of actually hiring. It's quite a cost to have a consultant come in there and do this, but they're a very credible organization and have had great success. I think they were working actually with the town of Essex and helping them, you know, even create their affordable housing trust. So they're a credible group. And we have this opportunity to say, will you come in and help us? So Chris and I worked on the application, put it together. They had some criteria. You all saw it. It did have to be in by today. So I submitted it, but I can pull it back if the trust says we're not interested. So, but I couldn't put it in after today. So, so we submitted an application and like I said, I can pull it back if the trust decides not to. I know Sarah had some concern. There's a lot going on. So,
yeah,
I have concerns regarding the timing of it. I think that with the 40B housing project, people are pushing back on the amount of development. I think we're trying to push the MHA, thing. And I think if we start doing outreach to the community, I think we're pushing too many buttons, and I think it would be more appropriate next year.
Sarah, are you saying that because of the perception that they're going to be promoting opportunities
for additional development
of our plan? Because I see how you can see that. When I read it, I thought, this is another resource the Affordable Housing Trust and the Housing Authority could use as we continue our engagement.
But my concern is timing. We're hitting people up with 136 unit development. We're trying to get DPW, which 20 to 30 units. And now we're bringing in a campaign to kind of push more affordable housing. And I just think it's too much in too short a period of time to do this all at once. That's, that's my opinion.
Yeah.
Next year, I would have no issue.
Sarah, I appreciate that. I don't see it as asking for more affordable housing. I see it as them supporting us doing the affordable housing that we have on tap and helping people understand why this is an important opportunity. And I also think it's important when the planning board goes forward next year, I think with its proposed changes to zoning, I think it will be really important that the town has had these conversations about affordable housing and how we can create it incrementally through our zoning, and how I just think it's a really broad conversation. And I hope people don't see it as trying to put make everything, trying to create more affordable housing. But I do think it's a discussion that will help the Affordable Housing Trust and Housing Authority maybe get theirs across the finish line and get a bigger coalition. But I'm happy to hear what others have to say too.
So if it's characterized as a campaign, I think Sarah is exactly right. And we'd be up against a brick wall. But if it's not a campaign, but rather trying to establish a dialogue and maybe tone down the divisiveness of what's going on right now, I think that might be very helpful just for the town in general. I mean, there are just so many people have so many very strong opinions, emotional opinions. And I think it's, I don't think it's just in Manchester at all. I think it's a national thing that's going on now. And just anything we can do to kind of try to keep ourselves, in dialogue with the opposition, because there's going to be opposition. I met with a neighbor of the DPW, a guy named Andrew Clark. I met with him the other day through a friend of mine who knew him. And I thought he was going to be part of the opposition to the DPW. Turned out he wasn't. He wasn't sure what he was going to do, but he said there has been quite a lot of misinformation thrown around about the DPW project. Mm-hmm. Somebody had said 80 units and he was concerned about that. So just anything we can do to further the dialogue and get credible information to folks so they realize we're not trying to take over the town. We're actually trying to preserve part of the town's character. I think that would be beneficial.
Yeah, I think it could be an outlet for people to not take all their angst to the ZBA meetings. If there's another outlet to really, I think if it's the best for the, if it's a really well done, we have an opportunity to listen and to speak, right? So we can really hear what the concerns are and have a really healthy dialogue. So I think it's wrong to think it's a campaign and we're trying to push that. I think we'd be faulty if we tried to do that. And there's even a thought that, the folks in SEMA, it's perhaps a bridge.
Yeah, in fact, SEMA is a great example of people I think we should be in dialogue with instead of, mm-hmm. And we're now opposing their two warrant articles. Mm-hmm. So, I'd love to have a much more useful dialogue with them than just us shouting at each other about how many units can be developed in town in any given year.
Right.
Yeah, no, that's well said. Joan, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, when I first read that, Sue, when you sent it out, I thought, wow, this is like, to me, it was a no-brainer. If there's an organization out there that does this, this is, I didn't see a negative. I, listening to what you're all saying about, Sarah, you probably see a lot more because of the other boards that you're on. You probably know more that there's more opposition out there. But I do think that, well, first of all, they're not going to start until whenever, right? It's not going to be this year. It'll probably be whenever they make a decision about who they're going to work with.
When would it start, Sue?
Yeah, I think it would start the beginning of the year, probably. They said that they would probably, they're endeavoring to get an answer to the community by the end of November. So I would think it would start at the beginning of a year. The beginning of January or something.
I would think that the preliminary meetings with them to see where they would head first or how they would steer this, or could we steer them? I don't know, but I think we should do it. I think it's, and if it doesn't work out, pull it back and just say thanks anyway. But we decided we can't do it right now.
Yeah.
And for what it's worth, CHAPA is a very respected group. In fact, they have their annual meeting tonight. We're all missing it.
Oh, no.
Oh, bummer.
Zoom meeting. I mean, it's not uncommon for the governor to be a keynote speaker or welcoming folks, but it's housing advocates, it's community organizers, it's real estate professionals, it's bankers, it's management agents, it's everyone under the sun who are promoting housing from every different angle that people have their interests. I mean, a banker, well, you know, bankers, they make money, they're all coalescing in this CHAPA group. So I think it gives them some cachet. And I think there are probably a fair number of people who are from SEMA who are familiar with CHAPA and see the important role that they could play. I have to admit, I was sort of like Joan. I said, can't lose. But then Sarah makes an interesting point that I hadn't mm-hmm. realized, that I thought this we could use CHAPA as support for our current plan mm-hmm. in any way possible. And not really, we're not talking next phase or what else we can do. And I'm just curious, would someone perceive that CHAPA is coming in and they're trying to create more discussions for more housing? I didn't see it in that way. I just think if we focus on our current needs and how we can get support from CHAPA, I think it could be successful. So for that reason, I would support it.
I just feel we're putting the community on overload. I think there was so much pushback on the 40R that people complained about that. You know, I think that there's just too many balls in the air. And I think people are going to be on overload. That's my personal opinion.
So we have CHAPA leading our Essex Affordable Housing Coalition, which is technically what we are now as we create the trust fund. And CHAPA, for us, we got them technically through a grant, so it didn't cost the town anything. And then they've been able to bring us, obviously, a lot more structure because we're starting from zero. But they're also bringing a lot of new and innovative ideas to the table, and also funding that we didn't even know was available from the state and federal government that we're going to apply for and we're going to get, and it's going to make a difference. And it's getting more resources for our community that, like, we didn't even know how to get, you know what I mean?
That's a good point, Tony. Folks who work at CHAPA are very connected to the state government, Department of Housing, Community Development, and in the housing industry. So I think there is a multiple level benefit to engaging with them.
Oh, I have a suggestion. I mean, we're just applying for this. We may not get it. But if we do get it, Sarah, I think what we have to do is make sure that they understand the concern that we are facing an overload of housing issues in this town, and whatever program they want to put together is going to have to address that.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I mean, you know, we've got the 40B, we've got the Manchester Affordable Housing Trust project, and then we've got the change in the bylaw for the ADUs. Yeah. And that's for a town that has not done much in the way of development. that's a lot to throw at people who don't want more density.
But guess what? The result of not doing it is the 40B.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. So. But people don't want to hear that.
No, I know they don't. And it may well be that they, when CHAPA hears this story, they may say, you know what? You might want to put this off for a year. Or maybe they'll say, well, let's start very slowly and do this and that, and then we'll see how that goes. And then maybe we'll pull the plug, or maybe we'll keep going, depending on what happens.
So do we need to have a formal vote on to approve the submittal that's already happened? I'm going to make a motion that the Affordable Housing Trust supports the application to CHAPA for the Municipal Engagement Program. Do I have a second?
I would think, but we need to leave it open-ended as far as what they're actually going to propose to us.
Yeah, I was gonna have clarify that in the quote unquote discussion part of the motion. That's subject to us one. Yeah, I agree, Sarah.
Yeah, I agree.
So how about this? How about if we amend your motion, John, to say that we approve the application subject to our guiding the design of the engagement
upon acceptance of the
if we ever get the yeah if we get it
yeah
although that's exactly what they say they that you do
yeah
well that's
that's why I was trying to structure a motion that just dealt with the application because what happens after
right
I mean, we say that's subject totally to, we voted to approve the application. But,
yeah, but John, with a lot of grants, it doesn't work that way. And that's why I think it's important to caveat it.
All right. So we just want
you know.
A motion to go ahead, Chris. You had it.
I can't remember it.
A motion to approve the application to CHAPA for the municipal engagement program subject to working out details regarding the engagement.
Well, I think how about having us oversee the design of the engagement.
There we go. If approved. All in favor? Chris?
You need a second.
I'm sorry, second.
I'll second it because
great. a vote. Is it inappropriate when I say a vote and I say all in favor? Or do I say vote and then I go Sarah and you say yay or nay?
You have to do a roll call vote when you're on Zoom. Last night on the 40B, I tried to adjourn without a roll call vote and Jonathan Silverstein told me I needed to do a roll call vote adjourn.
I'll do a roll call vote and I'll say those who approve.
No, you call on each person. Yeah.
Okay, so go roll call. Sarah?
Yes.
Chris?
Yes.
Joan?
Yes.
And then I approve as well. So the yeas have it. Nice.
I'm curious to be your thoughts, Gretchen. I know you're not voting, but.
No, but, well, I know that there's a lot of misinformation out there. I try not to get sucked into that Manchester thing on Facebook, but every once in a while I do. And there's just so much, you know, the number of units, what it's going to look like, just so many, you know, that I think anything that has anybody that we can get that has the know-how and the ability to get everything out in front of people, make sure everybody understands what's correct and make sure we're completely open, getting in touch with people who need to know. So I was definitely in favor of it.
I'm not a Facebook user, thanks. But I think maybe the first thing we tell CHAPA is to get on Facebook and see what's going on.
Yeah, honestly, you know, although you want to like slit your throat by the time you're done with it.
Excellent. So we just have two more items on the agenda, and they really deal with matters that haven't been recently anticipated or planning efforts that may or may, you know, that may be relevant, if there's anything to highlight.
I think everyone's probably pretty tuned into to what's going on. I'm happy to answer any questions people have, and I'm sure Sarah or Chris are happy to answer any questions regarding planning, but I don't have anything specific that I...
Yeah, I know Chris gave us some planning, and we know Sarah's going to be a very, very busy woman starting like next week or something.
It started last night.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And by the way, the planning board has named me as the liaison to the ZBA to handle the 40B.
So Chris will also be very busy.
I'm going to be busy with Sarah.
All right. Well, then the next meeting we've determined it's December 2nd, 6:30, and it'll be a Zoom meeting.
John?
It can be in person.
Yeah. Yeah, it can be, and it could be a hybrid.
I didn't realize that.
They were putting in the equipment this week at town hall. We'll just need to go through some training on it. Before you adjourn, I was just wondering if we wanted to invite Axel, if he had anything he wanted to say.
Axel Magnuson.
Does everyone know Axel?
Yep.
Yeah.
Axel, you have anything you want to say? Or are you being quiet?
You could have, it could be a placeholder here. He could be in another room in his house.
He may have given up on us by now. I just wanted to give him the opportunity if he wanted.
He's been there for a bit. I know Axel well enough that he would have.
All right. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you what then. We got December 2nd, 6:30. Do you have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Moved.
Roll call vote. Chris.
Yes.
Sarah.
Yes.
Joan.
Yes.
I vote to adjourn as well. Thank you, everyone.
Okay.
Thanks. Bye, everybody.
Thank you very much,
everyone.
Goodbye, everybody.
Bye. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.